First Peter chapter 3, we're going to read verses 8 through 16. So I'll begin on verse 8 and finish on verse 16. Please read the odd-numbered verses out loud with me. First Peter chapter 3, verses 8 through 16. And verse 8 starts, I think, with every Baptist churchgoer's favorite word. They like it when the preacher says, finally. We're going to start with that word, so we're not. Finally, be ye all of one mind, having compassion one of another. Love as brethren, be pitiful, be courteous, not rendering evil for evil, or railing for railing, but contrariwise blessing, knowing that ye are thereunto called, that ye should inherit a blessing. For he that will love life and see good days, let him refrain his tongue from evil, and his lips, that they speak no guile. Let him eschew evil and do good. Let him seek peace and ensue it. For the eyes of the Lord are over the righteous, and his ears are open unto their prayers. But the face of the Lord is against them that do evil. And who is he that will harm you if ye be followers of that which is good? But, and if ye suffer for righteousness' sake, happy are ye, and be not afraid of their terror, neither be ye troubled. But sanctify the Lord God in your hearts, and be ready always to give an answer to every man that asketh you a reason of the hope that is in you with meekness and fear, having a good conscience, that whereas they speak evil of you as of evildoers, they may be ashamed that falsely accuse your good conversation in Christ. And let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, thank you for your word. God, thank you for bringing us together. Thank you for those that will be watching over the internet. God, I pray that you'll speak to all of us and that your Holy Spirit will help us and strengthen us, equip us to serve you. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. About a month ago, I think it was on the 24th, I preached or taught. It was on one of our Back to the Basics Sundays. We had the kids quote the verses that they've been memorizing, verses commonly known as the Romans Road to Salvation. Some people use verses from various places of the Bible. I know a fella over in Marion, he goes to the book of Hebrews, and he shows the plan of salvation from there. And there's others that go to the book of Isaiah. And I'm not saying Romans is the only book in the Bible that has verses that can lead somebody to the Lord. it's all over the Bible. I like to use the book in Romans. It's all within a few pages. It's simple for me. That helps keep me from losing my place. And I found it to be something I can use. One fella asked C.H. Spurgeon what verses he used in the Bible to show somebody how to get saved. And C.H. Spurgeon showed him. He said, I go here, and I go here, and I say this, and I do this, and I do that. And the guy said, I don't like that plan very well. And so C.H. Spurgeon said, well, which verses do you use? And he said, well, I don't really have any. So naturally, C.H. Spurgeon said, I like my plan better than yours. And so I say that. If you don't already have a scriptural way to show somebody how to get saved, then feel free to, I say, borrow mine. I didn't come up with that. And I don't know who it was that came up with that. I know Baptists all over the world use those verses and that plan, that way, that road to lead somebody to Jesus. I think if you were going to be speaking to Jewish people, perhaps the book of Hebrews, people that were not Jewish just by blood, but by religion, the book of Hebrews might be very effective because it was written with the Hebrew people in mind. And so the background that they have is there for that. But anyhow, I mentioned during that message that we would follow up later with a little bit more practical how to put those verses to use, how to lead up to their use. And so today is going to be that. The Bible says here in verse 15, but sanctify the Lord God in your hearts and be ready always to give an answer to every man that asketh you a reason of the hope that is in you with meekness and fear. That word sanctify means to purify to make holy. And I got to thinking, how do we purify God? How do we make God? Well, God's already pure. God's already a holy God. But what it says there is to do that in your heart. And I think we would do well to have a good old-fashioned revival of, in our mind, in our heart, God being a pure and holy God. Yes. The world, the neo-evangelicals, the liberal Christianity has God chewing bubble gum, wearing Crocs, walking down the street in maybe cargo shorts or just playing hopscotch. They'd have him paint a smiley face on the back of the ark. And that's just not the case. The Bible tells us that it's a fearful thing to fall into the hands of God. And you can read throughout the Bible how God dealt with wickedness and how God dealt with sin and evil. And one of the things that was a problem in Noah's day was men's hearts were continually evil. And that word evil is addressed here in a couple of these verses that we read. And it says at the end of verse 12, the face of the Lord is against them that do evil. Verse 11 says, let him eschew evil. I looked up that word eschew. It means to shun or to avoid, to run away from. The last part of that word we still use when we try to get something to get away from us. Shoo. And that's, you look it up in the dictionary, that will tell you the source of words. And I think there was some French in there. And so when you tell a little kid shoo, or a cat, more likely, shoo, get away from that. Or a dog, come here. No. You're speaking French to that animal, or ancient French, perhaps. But that means to avoid. We're supposed to stay away from it. And verse 10 says, let him refrain his tongue from evil. And boy, the tongue is a powerful thing. And there's a lot of evil in, the potential for a lot of evil in everybody's tongue. I'm not saying everybody's tongue has a lot of evil, but there's the potential, the capability of it is there. Anytime you say, did you hear about so-and-so, there's a very dangerous thing that could be following that. If you're not about to tell good news about that person, you need to ask the Holy Spirit to help you guard against, or when somebody says, hey, come here, let me tell you the latest. 9 times out of 10, that's them building a case against somebody and trying to recruit you to help them continue to build that case against that person. That's not what we're going to preach about. That's all free. Let me read a verse for you just a few pages back in Hebrews 9. Hebrews 9:27 says this, and as it is appointed unto men once to die, but after this the judgment. Verse 28 says, so Christ was once offered to bear the sins of many, and unto them that look for him shall he appear the second time without sin unto salvation. It is appointed unto men once to die. That's the thing about this life. You're not going to get out alive. Now, if you're saved, that's a different story. But in dealing with people, in thinking about people, in looking about people, in talking to people, they are not going to make it out alive unless somebody does something. You were not going to make it out alive until somebody did something about it for you. The Ethiopian eunuch said, how can I know except somebody tell me? Somebody said, do you understand? Philip said, do you understand what you're reading there in the Bible? You got a book of the Bible. He didn't have the whole Bible even. He said, do you understand what you're reading? He says, is he talking about himself? Is he talking about somebody else? I need somebody to explain it to me. And people might say, oh, I've read the Bible, yeah. But they still need somebody to explain it to them. And the fact of the matter is, God himself, the Holy Spirit, the grace of God that bringeth salvation has appeared unto all men. At least one time, God has spoken to everybody's heart and said, you need to get saved. You have a need for salvation. There's an emptiness in you, and only God can fill that emptiness. Everybody is going to die. And not just they're going to die, everybody's going to stand before God in some form or another for judgment. Now the saved will stand before the judgment seat of Christ. That's a completely different type of judgment. A different atmosphere will be there. But the great white throne judgment, the judgment seat of God, is all unsaved. I believe we will be there as an audience to that judgment. I don't think we will be there in any way participating and standing before the judge, being judged there. All of our sins as saved people, all of our sins were judged on the cross of Calvary. That's dealt with. The judgment seat of Christ is more of an award ceremony. It's a judgment the way a sporting event is judged. And the victors, those that have excelled, they receive their reward for the way they competed and how they succeeded in that. Now, in the verses we just finished reading in 1 Peter, we find a time of persecution described. People being persecuted for doing what's right, for doing well, for doing good. Evil being done against them, and so much of evil has to do with words and speech, and a hostility towards Christianity. And in that time, we are commanded to be ready to give an answer of the hope that's in us. You know, we tend to shy away from the difficult times, the difficult things, affliction, hardship, persecution. And I'm not saying we should go out and pursue these things, but we also shouldn't get angry at God when those things come upon us. You see, it's during those times of darkness that a light shines its best. You know, we've got two little supplemental light bulbs here, and you say, they don't really give off a whole lot of light until you turn all the other lights out and you see, you know what, those do offer some light. I've got a little flashlight I carry with me at work, and it has I think it's called a turbo mode. And the flashlight I have now, I have because, and it's the second one I got from this company, it's the second one because the first one they had a recall. They said the button can get pushed while it's in your pocket and it can burn your leg. It gets hot because I call it my pocket supernova. And they were right, that button can get pushed. And because there was times that, man, why is my leg so hot? And I'd reach in, pull out that flashlight, and it was burning, and it was hot. And the upgraded version is when the light itself gets close to something, it dims down. So if you happen to accidentally turn it on while it's in your pocket, it stays on the dim setting, and it won't burn you. But the other people were getting burns, and they were starting to complain about it. And they said, we better do something. So they offered a recall, and they said, we can give you your money back that you paid for it, or we can give you 110% store credit towards another one. And I said, I'll take that store credit, and bought this other one that they had on special, which cost less than the original one, and was able to get another light in addition to that. So I thought it wound up being a good deal. But that light, when you shine it down into a dark tank or something, boy, it just lights everything up in there. But on a bright, shiny day, you can turn that light on full blast, and it doesn't illuminate as much. See, it's during those dark and difficult times that we as Christians have a unique and the best opportunity to let the light of Christ shine through us to a lost and dying world. The darker the world gets, the lighter our light should shine. And we need to be careful to not go along with the darkness of the world, or our light becomes covered with soot and the dirt and the filth of the world. Sanctify the Lord God in your heart. Get back to the realization we have a holy and pure and righteous God, and everybody is going to stand before Him someday. Now, last month, we covered the verses and a little bit about what those verses mean on teaching somebody how to get saved. See, when you stand across from that cashier, I want you to see somebody who's going to stand. They're not getting out of here alive. While in line, look back and say, does that person look like they're going to do something about this? And then say, probably not. So since somebody needs to do something about this, I guess it's going to have to be me. That's right. And if you have a whole long line of people behind you, you may not be able to take time to teach, to share the whole plan of salvation, but you can hand the gospel tract and say, I hope you would read this during your break. You might find it encouraging. Oh, everybody's looking for a little bit of encouragement. Everybody that has a TV set is looking for a little bit of encouragement, especially if they have the Clinton News Network on that TV. They're looking for a lot of encouragement. Or as that one guy used to call the other channel, PMSNBC or something like that. It's all bad news. It's all bad news. I miss Paul Harvey so much. He always had some good news and commentary on. They're looking for some encouragement. A few years back, we were at the Myers up in Mansfield. I was with my wife, and when I say we, it was my wife and I, and we were checking out. We happened to end up in a line with nobody behind us. She took an opportunity to witness to that cashier. And that cashier bowed their head right there and got saved. And it was almost like time kind of stood still while that was happening. And then we left them with a gospel track, and we left, and it was almost like, okay, everything came back into the music over the loudspeaker, started playing again, people started getting in the line that we were leaving. Now, nobody got in line while we were there sharing the gospel. As we left, now the line started backing up, and everybody decided to come check out. God arranged for that. He made an opportunity and caused the time and an opportunity, and we were ready to take that opportunity to share the hope that was in that is in us to somebody that didn't have that hope. Now, let me give you some things, and this is going to be a very practical. These are things you can write down and you can take with you, and you can study and memorize these things, and because one of the hardest things that people struggle with in witnessing, they may have memorized all the verses, or they may have marked them in their Bible or a little pocket New Testament. They know what verses to show somebody, but how do I get the ball rolling in that direction? How do I bring this? Because not everybody comes up to you and says, sirs, what must I do to be saved the way the jailer did to Paul and Silas? And not everybody. That happens very, very rarely that somebody comes up and says, can you tell me how to get saved? But when that happens, we're commanded to be ready to give them an answer. And let me give you some things that'll help move things in that direction. First of all, let me say this. The person asking the questions is the one controlling the conversation. The person that's asking the questions, they are directing the conversation. Let me give you an example of that. Have you ever considered the color chartreuse? And if you had never considered the color chartreuse before, me simply asking that question brought the thought to mind. Is it a greenish color or is it a purplish red color? And you can Google that afterwards and maybe surprise yourself. I was wrong when I had that question asked of me. So until I asked that question, you weren't thinking about it. Probably nobody here and nobody that winds up watching over the internet was thinking about that color at the time that I asked, until after I asked the question. So as you ask questions, you're able to guide conversations. There's some gentle questions you can ask to help guide a conversation in the direction of somebody recognizing and realizing their need for salvation. Because until somebody realizes they have a need for salvation, why would they get saved? Until somebody realizes they have a need to go to the doctor, why would they go to the doctor? I don't know anybody that's gone to the doctor and said, Doc, I just wanted to tell you, I wanted to spend some money here today to let you know everything is going perfect. See you when it isn't. I have a doctor. I think our family doctor is a very, very good doctor. I have two doctors. I have a local one, and then I have one that I call and say, here's what the local guy said, what should I do? But this local doctor, he wants to see me every year. Every year he wanted to see me. I said, Doc, I'm not used to seeing the doctor until I'm sick. I said, I don't dislike you. I hope you don't take this personal, but that's just the way I've been accustomed to operating. Because they wanted to schedule, all right, they brought me in, and I thought, why am I here? And so they could take my temperature and see how tall I was and how much I weighed and take my blood pressure and take some blood. I said, they're fishing. He's trying to find something wrong with me. And I said, how about when I feel something wrong, I show up. He said, all right. I said, I have to have a physical every year for work anyways. Maybe I can just call them and say, could you forward this, the results of this to my doctor and he can put it on my record. I said, because having two physicals a year, now that's double. That's two more than I'm used to having at any other time. He said, that's fair enough. But listen, there's questions you can use to guide a conversation and to guide it towards the plan of salvation. First question, have you ever or do you ever give much thought to spiritual things? And there's no right or wrong answer to that. Because maybe they do, maybe they don't. The idea and the use of the question is to now they're thinking about spiritual things. So if they've never thought about spiritual things, just the act of you asking that question, now they're thinking about spiritual things. And you say, well, I don't like that plan. If you have a better plan, if you already have a way of steering a conversation towards somebody's spiritual needs, then certainly don't scrap it and use this one unless you find this one to work better. Then certainly upgrade and use something that works better. But I found that's a soft question. It's not an abrupt, harsh. It's gently moving things in that direction. Hey, do you ever give much thought to spiritual things? Well, I can't say that I do. But what they don't say out loud is, I guess I am now. Thanks a lot for that. But now they are thinking about spiritual things, which sets things up for the next question, which by itself or leading with this question might be a little bit more harsh or intrusive. But as a second question, you've already moved them in that direction a little bit. And so it helps. And it sounds like we're going to manipulate somebody into getting saved. No, we're not. We're presenting the gospel in a way that is less likely to run somebody off. Mm-hmm. We're being wise as serpents and harmless as doves.
Right.
So the second question is, well, what would you say is a person's greatest spiritual need? See, it doesn't matter what they answer to number one. Now they're thinking about spiritual things. Well, what would you say is a person's greatest spiritual need? And I've heard many, many, well, love. Everybody needs love. That's a very good answer. That's I like that. I think everybody does need love. For God so loved the world. He said, I'm going to meet their most pressing basic need, love, and I'm going to demonstrate it by giving them salvation, which is the biggest long-term need that anybody has. Our short-term need, love, long-term need, salvation. And so whatever they answer, it doesn't matter. Well, I don't think anybody really has spiritual needs. Well, I think love is a big spiritual support. Help, you know, whatever they answer, that's fine. And you can say, well, how about preparing for the life that comes after this one? Because that would be the spiritual realm, wouldn't it? And so, and eternity lasts a whole lot longer than what this life, lasts. You know, we might make it 80, 90 years. I asked Elizabeth this morning, I said, how old do you think? I asked her how old she was. She said, 7. I just had a birthday not long ago. And I said, well, I'll have a birthday this week. I said, how old do you think I'm going to be? And she said, I don't know. I said, well, take a wild guess. And she did take a wild guess. She said, 79? I'm hoping that was a wild guess. I said, no. I'm going to be 52. And she said, okay, and went on back to her Sunday school class. but even if I make it double what I am now, if I make it to 104, compared to eternity, that's nothing. That's nothing. When you ask somebody what they think about, you know, when you say, what would you think is somebody's greatest spiritual need? Whatever they answer, and then you say, well, how about preparing for the next life? Oh, yeah. Now all of a sudden, it's like a light comes on. That would be a big need. That would be something special. And you go on and say, you know, the Bible teaches we're all going to die. Everybody knows that. They don't like to think about it much. They don't like it being brought up much. Some people get superstitious about it. I'm not even a little stitious about it. Don't talk about death. I don't want to talk about making my will. That just means I'm going to die. You're going to die if you make a will or not.
Right.
I don't want to buy life insurance. That just means I'm going to die. You're going to die whether you have life insurance or not. It is appointed and a man wants to die. And after this, the judgment. We're not getting out of this world unless somebody has done something. Unless you do something about it, you're not getting out of here alive. And unless you do something about it, you're not getting out of the next life alive. I should say, you're going to exist eternally somewhere. You're going to exist in eternal death, or you are going to exist in eternal life. It is appointed in the man once to die. And after this, the judgment. We're going to stand before a holy, pure, righteous God at some point. It's going to happen. I'm going to stand before a holy, pure, and righteous God in a father-son relationship. If you're saved, it'll be a father-child, father-son, father-daughter relationship. And you're not going to be wondering, which one am I? God is not the author of confusion. So the Bible teaches we're all going to die, and we're going to stand before God for judgment. Jesus said that those that are well don't seek a physician. There are people that are not well, but think they are.
Mm-hmm.
And they don't seek a physician. If somebody thinks they're okay, why would they seek salvation? A lot of people think the Ten Commandments were given to give salvation, and they're not. The Ten Commandments were given as a mirror. They're for you to look into and see something's wrong. That's what we use mirrors for. We use them to find out what's wrong. There's lots of times. I mean, you look in the mirror and say, ooh, it's going to take a lot of work today. Got to do something about this. And can you bring me that hammer? That's what, oh, the hair's out of place, it needs some work, whatever. The older I get, the more work I say, man, I didn't have to work this hard before. We see there's dirt, there's, you go in the restaurant, you eat, you go to use the facilities, you're washing your hand, they got a great big mirror there. Man, I got ketchup all over my face. Why didn't anybody at the table tell me I had ketchup? They said they're my friends. Now I see. Thank goodness for a mirror.
Mm-hmm.
The Ten Commandments are to serve as a mirror, so that we can look into that and see something wrong here. So a lot of times you'll find somebody that says, well, I know I'll stand before God. I'm really not that bad of a person. You can say, how do you think it's going to go when you stand before God for judgment? Well, you know, I'm not that bad of a person. I try to be good. Well, let's look at the Ten Commandments. You've heard of those, right? Everybody's heard of the Ten Commandments. Can you name one? Thou shalt not lie. Well, OK, Okay, it's not worded exactly that way, but that's the meaning of it. Okay, have you ever told a lie? Yeah. Well, thou shalt not kill. Well, that's in there. Jesus said, if you hate somebody, you're guilty of murder. Thou shalt not steal. Have you ever taken something? No matter how small, have you ever taken something that wasn't yours? Everybody's taken something that wasn't theirs, even if they don't realize it. You know, anybody that's ever taken a puff off a cigarette has taken something that wasn't theirs. You took some time off of your life. Your life doesn't belong to you. The earth and the fullness thereof belongs to God. God owns everything and everybody. Not everybody's saved, not everybody's a child, but God is the owner of everybody. And they've taken something that didn't belong to them. You ate something you knew you shouldn't have eaten. You took something that didn't belong to you. Anyhow, you looked at your neighbor's paper at school at any time for an answer. You took something that didn't belong to you. You're guilty of stealing. Mm-hmm. And most people that are trying to be honest will admit that they are guilty of having taken something that wasn't theirs. You can ask, if you're so bold, you can ask, have you ever lusted after somebody? And most honest people say, yeah, you know, I'm guilty of that. And Jesus said, if you've lusted after a woman in your heart, you've committed adultery with her in your heart. So now that they've admitted to these things, you say, all right, how do you think it's going to go for a lying, thieving, adulterous murderer standing before God on Judgment Day? See, when it was, I think I'll be okay because I try to be good, it's one thing. But when you say, you put a liar, a murderous, thieving, adulterous liar before a pure and holy God, how do you think it's going to go for them? And by asking these questions, you lead them to a realization of a need for a Savior. You see, God loves you. When we read about that, that we're going to, it is appointed in man once to die, and after this, the judgment. That's a courtroom setting. There's a legal term called remedy. You can look that up. And there's, when you break a law, there has to be a remedy for that broken law. For example, when you speed and you get caught speeding and you're found guilty of speeding, now there's a remedy and you pay the fine and court fees. I always wonder, why do I have to pay court fees? I'm not going to court. I'm just paying the fine. Yeah, we're going to get you anyways. Anyhow, that's the remedy. $150 or whatever it is they decide to write down on that thing. That's the remedy. In the Mosaic law, a lot of times God would say, all right, if you've got this ornery, you got this ornery cow and you've seen it try to poke people with its horn before and you didn't do anything about it, and sure enough, that cow killed somebody. Now the person, the survivors of the family members of that person that cow killed can come after you. And then they would say, here's the, it wouldn't word it this way, but here is what you have to do for them, or here's what will be done unto you because of that. You're guilty of this, you're guilty of this. And there's always a remedy in the law. And so when the wording in the words and the vocabulary used are a courtroom description, and God gives us a remedy. God loves us and didn't leave us without a remedy. The penalty, so we get into, this leads us into the Romans road, for all have sinned. And they've admitted that they're a lying, thieving, adulterous, murderous person. And they know they're going to stand before God someday. And without some remedy, they're going to be found guilty and cast into the lake of fire for all eternity. But God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. Why did Jesus have to die? as a remedy. That's right. If you have a stack of speeding tickets and you're standing before the judge and that stack has been placed up on his desk and he says, you've got $10,000 worth of speeding tickets here. Now, I'd never get that way. They'd take your license away. They wouldn't all be speeding. The first few would be speeding and the rest of them would be operating without a license, reckless endangerment and things like that. And somebody walked in the door and said, judge, I'll pay those. You know what would happen to you? He'd let you go. And whoever came in the door to pay for him, he'd say, you need to get your checkbook out. And that person would make the payment, and the judge would say, all right, you're free to go. It's all taken care of. That's what Jesus was doing on the cross for your and my sin. He's saying, I'll pay for those. That's why he died. That's why his blood was shed as a sacrifice. The penalty for sin is death. And so as Jesus died on the cross, he was paying my penalty. He was paying your penalty. When sharing the plan of salvation, make sure you don't ever present yourself as better than that person. So you know, without a remedy, I would stand before God the same way you would, and helpless, but for him to have mercy upon me. And the time for mercy and grace is now. It's not at that point. That mercy has been given towards us in Jesus, and that grace has been given to us in Jesus. And so without Jesus, we don't have mercy. Without Jesus, we don't have grace. And we need both. See, mercy is what keeps us out of hell. Grace is what takes us on up to heaven. Mercy is just, it leaves us. If all we got was mercy, we'd be left here. Or we would be put into a situation where we just cease to exist. Grace. Grace takes us. Grace is getting something we didn't deserve. Mercy is not getting what we did deserve. The penalty for sin is death. And when Jesus hung on the cross, he said, it is finished. What he was saying there was, it's paid in full. There's not anything more that has to be added to that payment in order for it to be enough. This idea of, I'll help Jesus save me. You've got the wrong Jesus if he needs your help. The Jesus of the Bible said, it's finished. I don't need your help. I'm done. It's done. There's nothing more that needs to be added to it. There's nothing more that can be added to it. You know, if you have a glass that's been filled to overflowing, and somebody says, can you put a little more in there? You know what the answer is? No. It's already full. It will not hold anymore. And Jesus filled salvation full. It's done. It is finished. And he said, Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit. And he gave up the spirit. He gave up the ghost. He laid his life down for us. So many times the hardest part is just getting the ball rolling. Just getting the ball rolling. Sometimes God will give that opportunity. I worked with a fella. He spent some time training me. The last place that I worked, got to ride along with him some. He's a Christian, saved man. And he was telling me about, he used to work as a roofer years ago. He said, I was up on top. He said, I was working with this guy, and he said, I was wanting to witness to him. The Holy Spirit told me I needed to share the gospel with him. And he said, I was timid. He said, I didn't know what to do, how to bring it up, what to say, to bring the conversation that direction. But I kept saying, I want to, I need to, I know I should, I know. And one day that guy slipped and he was sliding and he was headed off the top of that building. And he managed to, when he got to the bottom, grab hold of the gutters or something. His feet are dangling off the, I mean, his whole body's off over the edge. He's just holding on. He said, I made my way down to him and was helping him back up. He said, I'd like to talk to you about your eternal soul. He said, that fella said, I'd like to hear you talk to me about my eternal soul. I'm ready to talk about that right now. And sometimes God brings them to a point where they're ready for that conversation. But when he does, he's bringing you, and the Holy Spirit is prodding you. And we're so scared that person doesn't want to talk about this. And what we don't know is that the Holy Spirit has been prodding them to talk about it. They do want to talk about it. Let me tell you one illustration, and I'll finish with this unless I think of another one. Heard a preacher talk about where he was near a big state-run university like OSU. Maybe not quite as big, but it was a big place, and they would go soul winning on that university campus, and they'd go into the dorms and knock. They'd go door to door right there in the dorm, like a big apartment building. And he said they knocked on this guy's door, and the guy said, go away. Or he said, who is it? He said, it's a preacher in such a church. And the guy said, go away, I don't want to talk about it. And he left. The next week, he was praying and saying, God, where would you have me go? And God said, go knock on that door again. I've already knocked on that door. He said he didn't want it. I've already brushed the dust off my shoes and gone on somewhere else. Where do you want me? God said, go back to that door. So he went back to that door. Who is it? It's a preacher again. I told you, go away. I don't want to talk about it. So he left. Went and told other people. Next week, God, where do you want me to go today? I want you to go back to that door. Who is it? It's the preacher again. Go away. This happened like 3 or 4, maybe 5 times. It was several times, I know. Finally, that fellow opened his door and said, all right, come in. What do you have to talk about? And he shared the gospel with him. The guy got saved, started bawling. Just crying. Got saved. After he got saved, he said, you know, I'm so glad you kept coming back. He said, God kept telling me to come back. I didn't want to. You told me to go away. I was done. But God kept sending me back here. He said, I'm so glad. He said, I would tell you to go away. And then in my heart, I'd say, please come back. Please come back. And then you'd come back the next week and I'd say, leave me alone and go away. I don't want to hear about it. And in my heart, I'd say, please come back. Please come back. Please knock again one more time. What I'm saying is that person may look harsh and gruff and mean and hateful and evil and spiteful on the outside, but you don't know what's going on in the heart. And when God says, tell them, it's because God knows what's going on in the heart. And he sent you to speak to that need. Now, I'm not saying everybody you talk to is going to get saved. Because they're not. They're not. But at least everyone you've talked to, you get an opportunity to plant a seed. You got to plant the seed. You say, what if somebody's already been talked to and I tell them again? They still might not get saved. Maybe all you got to do, somebody else planted, you got to water the seed. And it might be the next person that gets to reap the harvest. Or the next person might just add a little bit more water to that seed. And it'll be the next person. But our responsibility is to go into all the world and to tell everybody. And that means maybe we're the one planting the seed, maybe we're the one watering, maybe we're the one harvesting, whatever. It's not about us. It is God that gives the increase. And unless the Holy Spirit is drawing them, there's not going to be a conversion. It's not a matter of 1, 2, 3, pray after me. All right, you said the magic words. I'm on my way. It's not an enchantment. It's a change of mind that leads to a change of heart. It's an understanding. I'm going to stand before a holy and pure and righteous God someday. And I will stand there as a lying, thieving. Have you ever taken the Lord's name in vain? Yes, you're a blasphemer. You've blasphemed the name of the one that will be judging you. How's it going to go? How's that going to go for you? When he said, thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain. For God will not hold him blameless. In other words, God said, there's no excuse for that. There's no getting around that. You can go down throughout all the Ten Commandments. James says it very clearly in the book of James. We find it very clearly. God wrote it for us. If you're guilty of breaking one, you're guilty of all of them. Guilty of all of them. Well, I'll be okay until they're confronted with that mirror. It's like a little kid that comes in from outside playing in the mud. Say, come in, it's time to eat. And he comes and goes right to the table and sit down. No. You need to go wash up. Why? Well, look at your hands. Oh, yeah. And when you get in there, look in the mirror at your face. And they come to a realization. And so many people think they're ready to go straight to the table from having played in the mud. Unless somebody can gently say, you need to take a closer look. And love should be our motivator. And love should be what carries our message. But it should also be carried without bending and breaking. It needs to be carried straight and true. If we care about other people, we'll tell them. We need to let them know, it's because I care about you. This is uncomfortable. I know it's uncomfortable for you. It's uncomfortable for me too. I don't like going around telling everybody you're going to die. It's not fun. And I tell them right off. I said, that day comes for all of us. I hope it's a long ways off for you, but it is going to come. Are you 100% sure you go to heaven? Or would you doubt it? Well, probably, maybe. Well, let's take a look. When you get somebody good and lost, they're a little bit more ready to say, what must I do to be saved? Mm-hmm. What must I do? Let's stand today. Every head bowed, every eye closed. We won't have piano for the invitation this morning. But perhaps God has already been talking to you about somebody, about salvation, about sharing the gospel with them. During this message, the Holy Spirit may have brought their name. Or you imagine them. You saw their face in your mind. You know, God said, you can talk to them about salvation. You can talk to them. You've been afraid to. I don't know how. Well, 24th of last month, I think it was. You can watch that message again. There's all the verses. You can watch this morning's once it's posted all over again. You can write those questions down. Now you know how to guide things. The most important thing you can do is this. Say, God, I'm not going to let fear keep me from that. But I need your help. I can't do it without you. I need your help. You think God won't help you? Do you understand how bad God wants them saved? Bad enough to hang his only begotten son on a cross in order to make it happen. That's how bad he wants them saved. He's waiting for you. God, go with me. You want prayers answered? Ask God to help you show somebody how to get saved. And go to our Heavenly Father, thank you for your word. Thank you for the salvation that you've given us so freely. Thank you for somebody. We all have somebody that allowed you to send them to us. We all have somebody whose path crossed our path, and they stopped and took the time to tell us about salvation and pointed us to Jesus. Now, God, help us to be that somebody for others. May those decisions be made here today and kept for the rest of our lives. For we ask it in Jesus' name. If God brought a name to your mind, why not come to an altar and just at least start by praying for him? God, here's somebody. You laid them on my heart. Save them. Save them. Help me to say something to them that'll move them in that direction. Use me. Well, the second best thing to being saved yourself is showing somebody else how to get saved. Best thing is getting saved. Second best thing, helping somebody else get there. Our Heavenly Father, as we leave here today, God, may it be as better equipped Christians to share the gospel, to be obedient to your command, to tell others, be ready. God, you told us to study. If it's something we want to be good at, we're going to have to study it, and you've commanded us to do that. We should become students of sharing the gospel. Help us to do just that. Return us again safely at the appointed hour. We pray that as we have opportunities to share the gospel, that you give us the wisdom, the boldness, and courage to take those opportunities and tell others about Christ, for we ask it all in his dear and precious name. Amen. Lord bless you.